Alright, to start off Unit 9, we're going to go over some basics on pages 1 and 2 just to get us some general information about gases. So, there are a few general properties we need to talk about. The first is the fact that gases can be expanded or compressed. That means that they can increase or decrease their volume. And that's actually because they have such a low density. That means that they have a very low amount of mass, very few particles in a large volume. And that large volume, the fact that there's big spaces between these gas particles, is why they can be compressed into smaller spaces. Gases are also fluids, so they flow just like liquids. You can pour a gas from one container into the other if it's heavier than air, just like what you do with water. Then these two words here at the end of this first section are very similar, but they are different. Diffusion is the process of gases spreading out, and it's always going to be from areas of high concentration to low concentration. Effusion, on the other hand, is all about gases escaping through a small hole or opening. So think about a perfume bottle being sprayed or air freshener. As you spray it, that gases are squeezed out through that small opening. That's effusion happening. They make a teeny tiny little cloud right there in front of the perfume bottle, but then that smell is going to spread out over some larger area. That's diffusion happening. So diffusion, effusion. Now, there is also some more generalized rules for how gases behave, and we can predict their properties based off of if they follow these rules. So this is what's called kinetic molecular theory. Sometimes I'm going to abbreviate this when talking about it as KMT. And the first rule is that gas particles are very small with large distances between them. So we already kind of touched on that with our discussion of density up above. There is no energy lost when these gas particles collide. They're colliding all the time, but it's what we call an elastic collision. They bounce off and we don't lose any energy. And because of that, our gas particles are in constant random straight line motion. They never get slowed down. If they hit something, they're going to bounce right back off with the same amount of energy. And they're constantly moving in straight lines, in part because they have no forces of attraction or repulsion between them. So they're not going to get pulled into a curvy line to get pulled towards another atom or pushed away from it. They're constantly moving in straight lines till they hit something, they bounce off in another straight line. And the kinetic energy of gas particles depends on the temperature. So think about heating them up, we speed them up. They move faster at higher temperatures. And that really leads us in to that bottom section there that talks about temperature. Well, what is temperature? It's a measure of the average kinetic energy of a system, specifically in this unit for gases, but this is true about any atoms and molecules. It's just gases move faster, so they tend to have higher temperatures. Now, this unit, we're going to be learning and using a new temperature unit. You already are probably aware that in science, we generally use Celsius. We don't mess with Fahrenheit at all. For this unit, all of our gas calculations are going to have to be done in Kelvin, which is actually the same temperature scale, like 1 degree Celsius is equal to 1 degree Kelvin. But we've shifted that Celsius temperature scale up so that there's no negative temperatures. And that's going to be important for our calculations. There was this researcher back in the day that realized the need for this. So he actually did a lot of research in order to figure out where the absolute lowest temperature possible is. And he defined that as absolute zero, which is what he decided is going to be 0 Kelvin. And at that point, there's no motion or kinetic energy at all. 0 Kelvin, 0 energy. And it's kind of a fun topic. We've never actually reached that absolute zero point. We've gotten really, really close, but it is still a theoretical place that we've never really been to or seen. But we base the Kelvin temperature scale off of it so that there's no negative temperatures. So as you can see here, that 0 degrees Kelvin, the absolute zero, is at negative 273 Celsius. And so as we're trying to do temperature conversions, we're going to have to turn Celsius temperatures into Kelvin a lot this unit. In fact, you could probably flip through this entire packet, and anytime you see something in Celsius, add 273 to that, and that will give you the new Kelvin temperature that you are going to need to use for the calculations that we do with that. So if you see degrees C, add 273. So here in these examples, if I have 25 degrees Celsius, I add 273 to that, and that gets us 298. We go down, 195C is going to be 468 Kelvin. Now, negative temperatures can exist in Celsius, but we still just take negative 40 plus 273, and that gets us 233 Kelvin. 23 Celsius is 296K, and 0 Celsius is, of course, 273K. We just take our degree C, add 273. It's very rare that you might be asked to go backwards and take a Kelvin temperature to turn it into Celsius, but if you do, all we've got to do is the opposite, subtract 273 from that Kelvin number, and that will give us our Celsius temperature here, negative 148C. Pretty simple. This is an important skill, though, so I'm going to have a little kind of challenge quiz for you to use to practice these conversions and get good at it, because I don't want you to have to sit there and think about what that number is or have to work hard to do that math. It needs to be automatic. We're going to do that a lot this unit. So moving on to page 2, at the top, there's kind of two sections we're going to talk about, and I'm going to focus first on the pressure stuff that I've highlighted here in yellow, and we're going to ignore that standard temperature and pressure stuff just for a moment. Don't scratch it out, but don't focus on it. So what is pressure? It's a measure of the force of the collisions between gas molecules, either hitting each other or those gas molecules hitting the walls of their container. So a pressure is a push, and we're going to be comparing that pressure in different circumstances and with different units. There are a lot of different pressure units, and you can see them all kind of lined up here. ATM is one of the most common units, and that stands for atmospheres. MMHG is technically millimeters of mercury. KPa is kilopascals, and PSI is pounds per square inch. So you're not actually going to have to do any conversions between those units, but you need to be able to recognize when you see any of those units, oh, that's a pressure unit, because you're going to be plugging that in for a pressure in an equation. So you're going to hear me probably say most of those words, what they mean, and you need to be able to match that up with those units that you see there. So that standard temperature and pressure part that we were ignoring for a moment, first off, we're going to use this a lot, and you're mostly going to see STP as the abbreviation for standard temperature and pressure. And you're probably not surprised if we have some common measurements that we're going to be making that scientists have standardized those measurements. And so our standard temperature is 0 degrees Celsius, which is actually 273K. Go ahead and cross out the decimals here. And we're just going to leave it at 273, just like what we were talking about on that last page. So that is our standard temperature, and our standard pressure is 1 atmosphere, meaning we have 1 atmosphere full of gases pushing in on us. Now, that is equal to 101.3 kilopascals, 760 millimeters of mercury, or 14.7 psi. And these are actually given to you on your equation sheet. We'll explore that a little bit more together in class. But you need to be able to recognize mostly when you see standard temperature and pressure, STP, flip back and find these values. You're probably going to have to plug in one or more of these numbers into your calculation. And then down at the bottom of that section, these temperatures were chosen as our standards because this is when our gases act the most like gases. And these are relatively high. I know 0 Celsius doesn't seem like a high temperature to us, but that is pretty high for gases and low general pressures. So that's when we can act the most like a gas, when our gases are going to act the most ideally. Now, real quick, in the middle of this page here, before we get into those gas relationships, I want you to go ahead and add a definition for volume, because we're going to be exploring and using this volume a lot throughout the unit. So volume is a measure of the amount of space a gas occupies. And while we won't always need it, you might need to convert between milliliters and liters a couple of times in this packet. So it might be a good idea to write down that 1,000 milliliters equals 1 liter there. So down here at the bottom of the page, we're going to look at how this pressure, volume, and temperature stuff we've been talking about change as one of the other ones change, because they are related, and changing one can cause an effect in the other. So the first changes we're going to talk about are between pressure and temperature, which means volume is being held constant. And technically, this is called the Gay-Lussac's Law. You're not really going to be tested over the names of the famous people that came up with these, more on the relationships between these variables. And so think about if we increase the pressure of a substance. Remember, pressure is collision, so our molecules are hitting each other more. That's going to cause an increase in their temperature. And if we have less collisions, less pressure, we also have lower temperature. This is what we call a direct relationship because there's changing in the same direction. If we were to graph that on that graph, it'd be a nice straight line. Whereas T is getting bigger, P is getting bigger. Smaller T's, smaller P's. Now, if we focus on pressure and volume, this is called Boyle's Law. And as we increase the pressure, think about like squeezing a squishy ball. As you increase that pressure, the volume of that is going to decrease. This is an inverse relationship. These are always going the opposite directions. When you release the pressure on that ball, the pressure goes down. That means the volume can go up. It can expand to take up that space. And as with any inverse relationship, this graph is going to be a little bit more of a curve where we have low volumes, we have high pressures, and vice versa. Low pressures are at high volumes. And then our third law is between volume and temperature, and this is called Charles's Law. And if you consider and think about heating up a substance, increasing its temperature, those gas molecules are moving faster, hitting each other harder, and they're going to try and spread out, which means that they're going to take up greater volume. And then, of course, the opposite is also true. At lower temperatures, the gas molecules can get closer, which means that their volume will decrease. And this is, once again, a direct relationship. So you'll notice our graph looks exactly the same as with that first law. So we're going to be investigating these relationships a little bit more in class. So make sure you have them down so that you can use your packet to help you.